Hi, I'm Sue. I'm here today with Anand. Hi, Anand. Welcome.
Thanks for having me, Sue. I appreciate it.
So, Anand, tell me a little bit about your role at Workplace from Facebook.
I'm responsible for our ecosystem partnerships at Workplace from Facebook. What that effectively means is my team of partner engineers and partner managers, we work very closely with technology partners such as yourselves so we can deliver better experiences together for our mutual customers.
Tell me a little bit about Workplace from Facebook.
Workplace from Facebook is an extension of Facebook's core mission, which is to give people the power to build a community. We haven't had a chance to do that the 8 to 9 hours that people spend at work working intensely with colleagues. And that's the problem we're trying to solve here, which is how do we build an experience for people at work that reflects the reality of who they are and how they show up at work.
It feels like we have an alignment at a mission level. Microsoft is about helping organizations and individuals achieve more. So tell me a little bit about the partnership. I know there's a lot of things we're doing.
At the end of the day, it's about serving the customer. And as customers try to piece together these various solutions, it's important that as technology providers, we come together to help them do that better. As we look at the customer base, we're increasingly seeing customers expressing to us the need to have a single source of truth on how they manage the users and manage the security controls. And so from our perspective, as we look at helping customers get the value from Workplace, we're experiencing that it's a better outcome for customers when we put identity, security, and the control plane in Azure AD and build a community and Workplace together so that Workplace inherits user management from Azure AD, groups, security controls, and then that flows into how content and people experience content inside Workplace. And that's a large part of the motivation behind why the partnership has been incredibly valuable for customers.
You know, you took the words right out of my mouth by saying that Azure Active Directory is the control plane. We say that a lot, but I mean, we truly mean that. You know, it's not just for Microsoft, but it's just simply the control plane from Microsoft. And that means that it can extend its capabilities to protect customers and users of Facebook so that everyone has that single control plane, as you were saying. I know at Ignite recently, we talked about the Azure AD as a preferred identity provider. Tell me a little bit about more how you arrived at that.
If you have the identity store in Azure AD, how do you provision people from Azure AD into Workplace? How do you deprovision them when they leave? How do you establish controls like maybe security policies through a control session in Azure AD that then flows in such that when content users or devices exhibit behavior that are probably a security risk or a signal that the content in there needs to be managed, we're able to flow through those policies as determined by the customer.
One of the things that excites me about this partnership is it's not just about the transactional things we can do today, but it's really looking at what we can do going forward into the future.
I think the last year plus has been about establishing the baseline and helping customers get these integrated experiences that we talked about. Now that we've done that and we're starting to put the engagement models in place so they're better support flows for customers, I think we jointly have a responsibility to co-innovate together to serve those customers better. I think there are probably three areas. The first, I think, is we can continue to make the experience better for administrators who deploy both our products, whether that makes provisioning and single sign-on much easier. So whether it's leaning together into standards like SCIM and FastFed or FIDO, I think a lot of opportunities with the work that you guys are thinking about and the work that we're thinking about to come together to solve those customer problems. So I think that would be area number one. I think area number two, both our organizations are investing quite a bit in keeping our customers safe, right? You guys invest a ton in AI and ML, trying to think about building a threat-free world. We invest a lot in making sure the communities and Workplace have a positive experience. And I think by working together, we can offer that to the customers that they could not otherwise get, which I think is an example of where the partnership could truly go deep, whether that means exchanging risk signals, around user access or other forms of data sharing. The third area is how could we jointly bring technology and the experience of community together for populations inside customer organizations that have historically probably not have an identity, had an identity in the organization, maybe because they didn't have an email address, not have had access to modern Workplace tools. But if we could put both our heads together and think through what it means to serve, Microsoft calls us the first line worker, we call it the frontline worker. How do we serve these incredibly impactful people who are the edge of the organization serving customers by bringing them together through our products.
Well, I think the first line worker is one that's super important to us. It wasn't until we really started talking to customers that we started to see more of the scenarios that we probably wouldn't have seen on our own. And we've actually designed features based on that. So now not only can they do it for things like HR, but they can do it for like sharing information between each other for how they do their job. And that collaboration that you offer in Workplace really opens up and gives a way for those users to be more productive.
So it sounds like you're taking the controls and the administration model one level down in the organization at the manager level to empower them to be able to help their people get access to these tools and products.
Not just for the administration and security, but for actually the productivity of those users as well. So it really opens up a way for you to get a lot more from the people you have than you would if they were working by themselves.
I think the key thing that we've learned is customers do not buy anything in isolation of what they have. If they have a tech stack, it's important that whatever we put in there works better together with those products where we serve the customer. On the identity side, it's Azure AD. On the productivity side, it's Office 365. On the internet side, it's SharePoint. I mean, there's like obviously a lot of investments that customers have put in, and Workplace Access, one of the better discovery and engagement surfaces for someone on a mobile device to see content sitting someplace else and engage with it and go back to where the content is. So we think of the news feed as a way for surfacing interesting information to an organization that you would not have found. And it ends up in interesting outcomes, which you totally did not expect. For example, let's say we have a new person on the Microsoft partnership next week. The thing I'm going to go tell them is go to Workplace and go look at the Microsoft partnership group. You will have content from like 5 years or 4 years or 7 years, and you will know the history of the relationship. And I think so knowledge management, giving people context so they can do their jobs becomes easier.
You know, there's a theme that's webbed across all of those use cases. And I'm thinking particularly where you talked about having the bi-directional communication, and that's inclusion. Like this ability for a conversation to not just be one way, and an ability for new voices that maybe haven't been heard as part of an organization to be able to express what they like, don't like, ideas, and so on. That's really interesting. I think our cultures are evolving away from, you know, just a top-down, this is how we do things, to more of a participative way for employees to be part of their companies.
Going back to the core of why Facebook is doing Workplace, the mission is to give people the power to build a community, but it's not in isolation of the realities of where we see the market going. I think there are like five big trends that we see in the marketplace. Organizations are getting flatter, to your point, participative. Mm-hmm. There is more remote work happening. There are five generations at work today. There's also this move towards people communicating and expecting the kind of stuff that they experience in their personal lives. And so engaging formats are a thing. There's also a fifth one, that knowledge is starting to reside at the edges of the organization. It could be that somebody serving the customer in a store has more insights about the pulse of the customer than somebody who doesn't engage with customers on a daily basis. And how do you surface that information back, which is to include those folks in the conversation, is becoming it's becoming increasingly a central part of how organizations want to have a conversation with their employees. So if you put those five things together, that's reflective of where the market is going. And I think as technology organizations, both Microsoft and Workplace from Facebook, I think we have an obligation to help further a workplace where everyone has a voice and build technology and product experiences that serve that goal. And I don't think any organization alone can do this. Back to our conversation about like frontline or first line workers, we're gonna have to give them access to technology through some form of identity that is low friction. And if people can provision themselves or access Workplace through Azure AD, through a phone number rather than an email address, that's great. You've lowered the friction for these, as you call it, the middle managers, the store administrators. It allows for those people to have access to Workplace and share their learnings, get support and help from others who run into similar problems, or share customer feedback and hear from the leadership and engage with them. I think the joy of a CEO liking a comment that you put in, where you've never seen the person ever or feel intimate with the person, is just like magic, because it's an acknowledgement that the work you're doing is visible. That diversity of voice and thought and knowledge actually leads to better business outcomes.
As interesting, I think, as you talk about that notion of the knowledge at the edge, It's also about putting the provisioning, it's putting the management at the edge.
Yeah.
Because organizations are much more agile and people move more than they did in the past. And so that ability to be able to make sure that users are properly administered and managed is super important in the world of cloud speed, as they would say. Also for that information to come in quickly. You know, you could survey the edge, but that isn't going to give you the sort of the metabolism of business that you need to be able to respond quickly when things change.
For a long time, people didn't think about the problem. And now the goal is to like figure out how to solve it. The interesting thing that you highlighted is, yes, we need to solve for the user experience, but at the end of the day, there's also an administrator in the middle. You're actually adding to the person's job by now helping them give these new set of tools to a population that they didn't have to think about, which means unless you make that middle step for the administrator easier, you're never going to be able to fulfill the mission, which is why I'm really excited about the investments that you guys are making on making identity and access easier, low friction, more secure.
And it gives us a chance to actually achieve the threat-free world.
There you go.
So Anand, I'm a voracious reader. What would you recommend I put on my reading list?
The one that I have personally found useful in the last year is investing and thinking about mindfulness. It's really easy when talking about inventing the future to always be in the future and think about what next. But ironically, it's really hard to do that unless you're deeply grounded in understanding the problems that you're trying to solve. And to do that, active listening and mindfulness is like has been helpful to me. So the book that I've been that I would recommend to you is Mindfulness for Beginners by Jon Kabat-Zinn.
I read a book once by Max Strom called There's No App for Happiness. And one of the things that he says in there is that we always are living in the future.
Yeah.
Or we're just basically never living in the present.
Yeah.
So he says, you're at yoga class and you're thinking about what you're going to have for lunch. And then you go to lunch and you talk about what you did in yoga class.
Yeah.
And I thought that's a really interesting way of thinking about how it's so easy to not be here now. So I actually made a New Year's resolution that my 2020 year was going to be present.
That's interesting. It sounds like you're on your mindfulness journey as well. Tell me more. I'm curious now.
Well, I started meditating about a year and a half ago. And I find that it is a way to center me in ways that I hadn't expected. For example, one of the things I've noticed is when I'm in a really crowded room and a lot of people are talking, as I've gotten older, I've not been able to like listen to you and ignore all the other voices. Since I've been meditating, I can now focus on you and I can tune out the rest of the noise. So Anand, I really want to thank you for taking the time to be here today.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me. The partnership with Microsoft Azure AD is really important to us and our customers. So we're really excited about the work we've done so far and the work we look forward to doing together. Your team has been great.
Thank you. On to the future.
Yes.